It's a real honor to be able to have you all here. I'm looking out in the room, and most of you I don't know, but more than zero I do. That took my marketing research class sometime in the last few years, and those folks will recognize some of the content I present here because I use the work I'm presenting here in class as a way of sort of demonstrating how to think about sort of this interplay between academic research and practical, real-life, actual industry. So this talk is going to be about a peculiar pricing mechanism. And it comes from two places. So there's two parallel stories, and I'm going to show you how they overlap. So the first is from industry, where I'm going to talk about how there's a problem with pricing that is extremely practical in a number of businesses. And I'm going to try to mesh it with this other completely different line of thinking that comes from academic research, where those are just economists and psychologists thinking about how people behave, not thinking about pricing at all. But the combination of that need out there in the world and this sort of built-up amount of knowledge, scientific knowledge, end up working pretty well together. Okay. So here's my industrial problem. So pricing, by its design, is like the least innovative thing that could ever be, right? You go to the store, and almost everything you consume, there's an item that has a fixed price, and you interact with that fixed price. Now, setting those prices, that's super elaborate and difficult, and I'm not trying to trivialize it, but at some level, the price is just the price. And so in lots of industries, they might be careful about saying, should we charge $19.95 or $19.96? You know, maybe that matters, but it's not a real innovation. That's despite the fact that we can think of industries where pricing is a huge, huge problem for them. So I highlight these just because they're so resonant in this situation. But we think about the music industry, the recording industry, where over the last number of decades, they've continuously tried to figure out how to handle pricing when technology is changing. So you're pricing 45s and you're pricing LPs, and then there's CDs enter the market, and there's this huge boon for the recording industry. And then spontaneous things are available as online downloads, and people pay for that for a while. And then there's subscription services, and then there's people that are illegally, you know, sharing music online. You say, it's impossible. And if you talk to anyone in the recording industry, they will generally be angry. They think someone's out to get them, and they're definitely disappointed. So you say, okay, and so they are trying to figure out the right answer. How do you solve this problem of putting prices on goods, on music, in a domain where free is super salient? So they need something new. Now, part of the reason pricing is not innovative is partially that it seems boring, but the other part is that because it is so saliently something that we work on, it's constantly being optimized, right? When you go there and broccoli is being sold for $2.26 a pound, you have some belief that someone really got to that carefully, right? So it seems unlikely that you'd be able to immediately say, like, oh, let's make it prices better, right? Because they should already be pretty good. So in order to do that, we're going to go pretty far away from where prices usually come from. So let me tell you this other story that was happening over in academic land, where those folks sit in, like me, sit at our desks and stare at computers and write academic papers that are read by other academics, therefore making sure that no one in the world knows about anything that we do. So economists and psychologists have, for the last few decades, gotten better and better at understanding something that is called social preferences. And social preferences, whatever the label is, these are all those things that don't quite look like regular, pure selfish behavior. Right? Economists are good at doing the regular stuff. It's saying, okay, you know, that this person has this much demand for a product, the price is this high, they will choose to buy or not. And obviously everyone wants to be selfish in that situation. But then you can think about the other things like, oh, fairness and reciprocity and generosity. Right? And you say, okay, this broad category of behaviors that don't quite feel very economic-y. So they've learned a lot about when those things occur. but mostly in sort of these peculiar situations, either experiments that are designed by economists or psychologists that are very contrived. And what they're not is particularly mimicking that experience that you have when you go to the store and you buy something. At that moment, for as interesting as humans are, at that moment, they really are kind of just like the fairly straightforward economic model of the person who says, wow, broccoli costs $27 a pound, no broccoli for me today, right? Or the person says, broccoli is very cheap, I will buy. It's very straightforward. But those social preferences still exist. It's just that the regular pricing environment doesn't operate on them. So the work I'm going to do is going to look at where I can, if I can take these social preferences and think about them in terms of this pricing context, right? They're pretty far away from each other, except for this really weird mechanism that I'll talk about for the next hour, which is pay what you want pricing. Now, as I go through this, I'm going to show you some studies I've done, and I'll talk about them, interpret some data, and do all these things. It's important to know, so you're all extremely practiced from your years at Haas at interrupting the person in the front of the room and asking questions. I strongly encourage that. If I just talk, it'll get, you know, a little bit, it'll get boring. So you're allowed to say, that makes no sense. Or even better, to say, what about this? Turns out I've tried to do a whole lot of research in this area. And so, although it's a very narrow area, I'm as close as you will ever get to an expert. And so I would love to answer any questions as they come, not just at the end. All right, so let's get into it. So pay what you want pricing. It is exactly what it sounds like. We can look point in a few different ways as to where it starts. This is the one that is most famous. So Radiohead is a British rock and roll band. Many of you know that already. Those of you who don't, you just learned something kind of important. They're very popular. So in 2007, they, like most bands, had been under some horrible contract with their record label. And they get to the end, they finally finish their contract and they say, we're going on our own, we're going to record our own album, we're going to release it as a digital download on our own website, no middleman. And then they do this, the last weird thing, this is their album In Rainbows that came out that way, and they said, we're going to allow our customers to pay any price they want for it. Right? So they say, it's up to you. If you click a button, it says, no, it's really up to you on this, because customers don't believe it. And so we say, great. So they offer their album for free. And you could say, was that a success? And here I say, probably. And that's for a few reasons. One, Radiohead are very many things. What they are not is transparent in reporting their data. So we don't really know quite what happened. ComScore estimates what happened, and they say that about half the people who downloaded the album paid something. Right? You say, okay, that's kind of interesting. And it's around this point that, so I tell you about how I got into this was because of this, but it wasn't just because Radiohead did this, it was because of how that fact I just gave you was covered. And that is, so that is the fact being half the people who downloaded the album paid something for it. The Wall Street Journal reported that as Radiohead has committed a major error. Only half the people who bought their album paid anything for it. Which I think of in the world of glass half full, half empty, they're seeing it as half empty when the other half of the glass is full of money, right? And you say, and that's because these are people who could get it for free, and a lot of them bought it. So we don't know. One estimate, this is also related, you might care for Radiohead, this is frequently cited as possibly the most purchased album in history, right? Because you reduce friction so low, and it's a very popular band. Lots of people got In Rainbows. Okay. Please. Got it. So we don't know for sure, but the number I'm giving you is how many people essentially have In Rainbows on their hard drive, right? Was from that time? Yeah.
Do we know, was it objectively a good album?
I so want to answer that.
Were there critical reviews of it before they said, and you can pay whatever you want?
Cool. So, So the timing isn't...
Can you repeat the question?
Absolutely. I'll repeat the question. He says, wait a minute. Do we have any information, and did the customers have any information, about whether or not this was an actually good album? Right? You say, like, what do we know about the quality? As it turns out, so first of all, Radiohead is lots of fans and super critically adored, right? All critics just so excited. Right. Yeah, okay. And so this one, when it, of course it came out, it was like a surprise. Not like Radiohead's like, we're going to be coming up with a Pay What You Want release. Radiohead, again, very secretive. They didn't even announce they had an album ready. So they announced the album and at the price all in the same moment. Then you start getting critics afterwards. But you can imagine the first set of people who go to buy it have no idea except Radiohead. They know Radiohead, the brand. Good. Okay. So these are the easy questions to ask. I mean, easy to ask, hard to answer. Is it profitable to ever use Pay What You Want pricing? And is it more profitable? And when I say more profitable, we're thinking like more profitable than what? Right? And that again, we don't, like for Radiohead, you're like, they did this, what was the alternative? We don't, we can kind of construct some stuff, but we can't really observe the counterfactual. So we're gonna try to get to that. So these payments, reflecting where I came from with this discussion of social preferences, are necessarily interesting also just by understanding people. Because you say, wait a minute, if I offer you something for free, why would you pay for it? That just seems super weird. And I have this note actually just for myself to mention that people work pretty hard at trying to rationalize the behavior. I'm not that style of researcher, of being an economist who adjusts what the rational model would be. What I'm gonna try to do is understand sort of psychologically how this works, and I'll show you what that looks like. So this is what I tend to focus on, saying when I choose to buy, I'm signaling something to the cashier, to my friends, to me, and I'm gonna talk about that. You had a question? Interesting. Yeah, let me as I talk through it, let's see, I want to circle back to it. I want to show you a few of the observations, and we'll build it up. But it's going to be complicated. So let me start with this. This is a board game, not a board game, a card game. It's like a board game. Cards Against Humanity, enormously entertaining. The game's pretty entertaining, but actually the people that run it, turns out that's like my favorite conference call ever, is chatting with these guys. So what they did, so they sell this game, people play, and they say offensive things. That's more or less how it works. You can play it at home if you want to be offensive. And what they did is, in one winter, they said they release a holiday pack of cards, right? So these are printed cards that they put in an envelope, and they send it through the mail if you buy it, okay? I mentioned all of the printing, sending, because this is going to be a notable, you're like, that costs something. Like, that's not, they can't just deliver it for free. So, and they said, you can pay any price you want for this. So it's another pay what you want effort. But this time, the reason I talk about them is A, because theirs is kind of interesting, different than Radiohead, and B, because they were willing to share their data with me, right? So I can show you exactly what happened. So, I say it's sort of free, sort of you can pay what you want, but it turns out if you pay less than $3, they reprimand you, and I'll show you the reprimand. So this is a little colorful, so if you're squeamish, don't read. So they basically say, you know, you're being a jerk. I mean, you can do it, but we won't like you. So when you see that, you're like, well, all right, I guess it's still that you can pay any price you want, but man, like, that seems pretty grim. So now we can ask, like, does that work? Like, how did it go? And so let me show you. So this is the distribution of payments, and I also point this out because it makes you realize, like, things don't, it's not like a clean little normal distribution of payments. Like, three, remember, that's the special one. That's what they call their break-even point. And a lot of people pay that. But it's not the most common. Zero is common. Like, that is, you know, 15,000 people paid zero.
So are those
But
before or after the motivational message?
Great question. Yeah, so all I observe it's necessarily after the motivational message. I observe their actual.
Of course you want to get, especially if you can spike it to $5.
You want to see.
Even though they're like three, you could, I mean, if someone tells me it's three and I, you know, didn't treat them fairly, I'd probably be motivated to pay something in the 4 to 6 range, right?
Cool.
And
I'd yep. I totally agree. So this, the Cards Against Humanity guys, very successful business, really entertaining. What they are not is very good at programming. And so when we chatted with them and when they were gonna do this, we're like, hey, can you show us like the stream, the behavior over time? Like, do they get the message, then change their price? And they're like, they said, no. I don't even know what you're talking about. That sounds impossible. Maybe in the future people will know how to do that. But the $5 amount, you say that it's like it's going above this other thing, and that's true. It is also notable. This is the number that is the default number when you show up. Like if you see the empty box, it's not quite empty, it has a grayed out 5. And so there's some notion that in a world of pay what you want price, like I have no idea how much to pay, there is a 5 there.
Suggestion.
Like that sounds pretty good, right? And it's sort of sending it, and so it's a little bit of a, it's enough to move us in that direction. Okay, this is overall, so they cost a lot of money to send these things out, they made a lot of money, they made some profit. They actually end up giving all of this money to charity, which is kind of neat. But it was collected in the form of regular for-profit enterprise, and they made money selling these cards at pay what you want, which seems kind of good. Okay, so easy conclusions. People pay more, often, modally, pay more than they have to. And you should now ask, well, maybe that's something about that company and it's that and the red reprimand and so on. Maybe it's not general. Yeah.
When they were asked to pay, did they know the money was going to charity?
No, they did not. Yep. And that's going to matter because I'm going to show you what happens when you start identifying money as going to charity. So, but this one, they're just giving money to Cards Against Humanity, and then the charitable aspect was what happened at the end.
By
yeah.
Paying more than they have, you mean consciously choosing to.
Yeah. Oh, right. Basically, just saying. Here I'm setting them. Yes, right. Money actually came out of the pocket, and they're actively engaged in what's happening. Okay. So those things cost. What if we sold a good that had no marginal cost? Right. That seems like that's where the good stuff's going to be. That's Radiohead. So I can't get access to Radiohead, but I got access to another artist. So long ago. Before I became a professor, I was a radio DJ. Radios are these devices that people used to use to listen to music, and the DJ was the person that didn't have any friends. So I did that, and it meant I knew a few record labels through that role. And so an artist released an album as a pay what you want download, and I was able to actually reach that artist and that record label and say, hey, can you share your data? So I have 15 months worth of pay what you want download data, and I'm just gonna show you what it looks like. There's also this great survey question at the end, which you'll see. First of all, here's the artist. I can't tell you who he is. I can tell you he's great. Not that that'll help him or you. So, but there's a photo of him. And you might say, so what happened? So first of all, I mentioned it's his fourth album. His first three sold on the order of somewhere between a few hundred to a few thousand, right? Which, if you know any musicians out there, like a few thousand sounds pretty good, but it's not the Beatles, right? This album had over 600,000 downloads. Most people pay zero, like that now. Yeah, zero is definitely the most common, but a lot of people don't pay zero. 95% pay less than 5, 99% pay less than 10, the remaining 1%, they mostly pay 10. Okay. The average is about $1.50. You put all that together, and you say like, whoa, that's real money. This is a guy who, for previous albums, probably didn't even list sales on his tax returns. Actually, having talked to him, my guess is this probably didn't make it to his tax returns either. But the point is, But real money, spontaneously. So, and here it is. This is an easy chart. It's just showing downloads over time. And you see the yellow bars are showing that you get a lot of downloads at the beginning and slower and slower, and that prices reflect that. You can think of this, this doesn't have to be the case, but it basically is showing the people who like the album most buy it early and also pay the most, right? Because they like it the most. This is nice feedback and tells us there's something reasonable going on. And this is the survey question. If you chose to pay zero, you had to answer this. So this, I'm going to show you 500,000 observations or something to this single question, which says, why did you choose to pay nothing? And there's a handful of answers. I'm going to highlight two of them. The first is this one. Very few people say that they don't believe in paying for music. Now, if you, again, find someone in the recording industry that wants to complain about why they're not making as much money as they used to, the standard answer is kids these days feel like they don't have to pay for music. That's not quite right.
Did you randomize the order, or is this the order they were presented for everybody?
Randomization technology was not possible for these guys either. this is the order they were presented in.
Okay.
Yeah. So I like that. But the other one I like is this, because this is going to matter. You say, I may donate later. What does that even mean? Like, no, I'm paying nothing now, but that's because I only pay on Thursdays. It's just the way, and then the other one is, I can't afford to pay. Remember, the price is zero. They're like a penny. They're like, oh, pennies are worth so much these days. I can't give those up, right? So, and that's a whopping two-thirds of the sample gives an answer that feels like not quite rational, right? So that's amazing to me. Yeah. Yeah.
No, but still, that might be what's driving that number is, well, I haven't heard it yet. If I listen to it and like it, maybe I'll go back.
That's right. And I think there is room for that. There's a few neighboring industries where, like in software, there's a few where you can get, the idea is you'll get a piece of software, try it out, and then only after a couple of weeks will the company say, hey, would you like to pay for that now? Right, and you can imagine if these people are thinking in those terms, then it is possible. Like, I'll come back later, even though they're probably don't. Actually, just chatting with them, they don't even know how to observe whether anybody came back. But to first approximation, their assumption is that no one did. That's totally reasonable as the way they might be doing it. Yeah.
So this might be coming later on in your presentation, but I'll ask now just in case it is and get you paid. So what we're talking about so far are differentiated goods, mm-hmm. or at least surprise goods. You don't know if it's going to be differentiated. So there's value and surprise. Have you had any experience with commodities? Things that you could get elsewhere that I offer you to pay nothing for what you do.
So, yeah, I mean, yes and no. So it depends. The number one thing that I sell, and I'm not even going to show you any of this data today, is donuts. I sell a crap load of I am the number one donut vendor on campus. That's like a boast. Actually, that's just a boast. That's a boast. I sell a lot of donuts. And donuts are kind of like a commodity. Right, then, like, you know, donuts are donuts. The reason they're not quite a commodity is that the people who buy donuts, they want a donut right here, and I'm the only one selling donuts right here at that moment. Right, so there's a little bit of, I don't have data that's in the form of like doing pay what you want gasoline or something, right? But you'll sort of see like it's there at the margins for a few things in that I present. Okay. So. These are different products, the cards, the music, they both do well. That's nice, at least. I haven't told you whether they could have done better or would have done worse if they'd used regular prices, though, right? And that is the standard that we want. Now, in order to do that, we could do a few things. We could model what would happen at different prices, use known algorithms for predicting behavior in some way, but that's hard, right? And you'd be dissatisfied. The way you want to solve this is with experimentation, right? So that's what I'm going to try to do. I'm going to run experiments where I randomly assign some customers to see pay what you want prices, and other customers are going to see fixed prices, okay? And we're going to compare those. So the first of my experiments, and I'm going to show you three of them. The first of them is from a scenic boat tour. And so this actually is not literally the boat. This is the boat that docks next door, because the captain of the boat that we ran the experiment with, He's like, don't show my boat. He had tattoos on his arm. He looks really scary. So we didn't do it, but here's the boat next door. So we go to the tour boat, and when everybody gets on the boat, their photograph is taken, and then they go get on the boat, and their photograph is printed. Oh, here's them on the boat tour. It's not there, and that would be a long boat tour. But the point is, it's printed, and the prints are displayed on these boards so that when they disembark, they would walk past and they could choose to buy their photos that had been taken an hour earlier, 2 hours earlier. Okay. This is not the photo, but I'm in this photo, and it's from a boat tour, so there I am up there in the top left, so that's why I use it. And we offered people three different prices. Some people, we said, the photo is $15. That is the standard price that this company uses for selling their printed photos. Other people, we said, the photo is $5. Pretty straightforward. And in the last category, some people were told, today you can pay what you want for the photo. Okay. So I'm going to observe two things. I'm going to observe how many people buy, and I'm going to observe how much they pay. Right? And I'll show you the results, but before I do, it's worth at least taking a minute and saying, what do I think? What's going to happen here? How many people buy? Who buys more? How much does price matter? And so on. Yeah? That's interesting. My strong guess is that they do know what the regular price is. That is not officially a part of the study, but the reason I think it's likely is that there's enough signage that's sort of like built in, suggesting that the photos are typically $15, right? And so I think that there's some argument for this study in particular. They will think of pay what you want as like, hey, it's usually 15, but for you, it's pay what you want, like sort of a promotional thing. And so that is like, think about it. It is a possible issue. It's not going to show up in the other studies I present to you as much, but I think here it might actually matter. So they might have that reference price. Okay. How many buy? So first, yeah. So for $5 versus 15 sounds good. People are more likely to buy when it is cheaper. That's like score a point for economics or humans. Depends on how you want to score it. People like money and they like photos. Sounds good. But then we get to our first of the interesting findings to me, and that is that people are less likely to buy at pay what you want than at $5. Now that's weird, right? Because you pay what you want. I can get that photo at any price I want to pay. I can get it for free. And they're buying it less often, right? They do. Oh, yeah. So all of the narratives, I'm going to talk about people making these decisions, and it all feels like, oh, they choose to buy, identify how much to pay. In real life, watching this stuff happen is basically just watching, for most customers, they are clearly ill at ease with the whole situation, right? Now, that doesn't make them go home and cry, right? They still buy products, right, in these situations. But you can tell, and so the standard questions, the last study I show you is where I know the most about it, but they tend to say, it's like the Radiohead narrative, but now with interpersonally, where you say, someone says, hey, today you can pay what you want. Customer typically says, what do you mean? Like, no matter how well we describe it, they're like, nah, that can't be. Then you explain it again, and they're like, how much do other people pay is common? How much should I pay? They'll just ask. They'd be like, how much should I pay? Well, wait a minute. No, the whole idea is that you get to pay. All right, we have all these scripts written out for our research assistants to make sure that they're not biasing in these situations. But people definitely, it is hard, like the decision to do it. And so when I see that 55%, I'm thinking there's 45% of people who are like, oh, I don't want to deal with it. Right? I don't want to deal with that anxiety.
So do other people see you make the decision? And do you see the other people watching you make your decision?
Cool. All right, so do people observe you making these decisions? That matters a lot. In this case, they almost certainly are being observed by other people nearby. We've run a number of studies trying to look at different versions of how much being observed matters. And so, again, take Jason's question and you say, what would you expect? And here, you'll be surprised to learn anonymity isn't a big deal.
Really? That's
And so, and that is to say, we run studies. I'm not presenting them here, so I'm just telling you about them. We run studies where we, instead of having people pay directly, we give them an envelope that, and they put money in it, and they walk 25 feet away and drop it into a box, right? And you say, wow, like that's, they are not going to pay. They pay almost exactly as much as if they're paying directly. Now, there's a different type of anonymity that might be the super low stress form of downloading the Radiohead album. And there you might say, you're not really anonymous. There's a credit card and everything, but you're anonymous in the sense of there's no human pressure at that moment. And that one, I believe, can have more of an influence. And most of the ones I'm going to be, in the studies I'll show here, it's all humans and humans. I have a number of things that are online as well. And again, people definitely don't pay zero in those situations, but it all depends on the context. Yeah? Reciprocity matters. So they will say that it does. So reciprocity, is it a factor? One way of thinking about it would be saying, all right, if the company did something $5 nice for me, I should do something $5 nice for them. And there's some of that. Definitely, so one of the things, if you ask customers how they chose their price, one of the things they'll mention is how much it cost to print the photo, how much effort went into it. But really, that's actually, it turns out, I think that's them not quite rationalizing, but converting a more general sense into a number. That what they overwhelmingly are influenced by is a sense of, like, what is fair and appropriate in this situation. And cost is part of it, but it might also be, well, everybody else here is paying a lot, so I should probably do it too. Yes. Yes, exactly. Right. And I think that there is some well-being that gets tied up in it, like, oh wow, they're letting me do this. I should be nice. And there's a hint of that also. Yeah.
Isn't it also that we're accustomed to seeing a value or a price, and if this were more widespread, then maybe that number of 55 would be different, right? It's that we're just not used to it. We've never seen it before, so it's a novelty. Whereas if more people did it, then it wouldn't be so stressful or so.
Yeah. Yeah, so, and actually, so thinking about that, you say, what if it happened all the time? We got really fluent and comfortable with it. There's a handful of predictions that you could make. Many of them are grim, right? You'd be like, oh, because like, why? I'm only getting 55%, so that's 45% who are like, I'm not going to buy it. Well, okay. But you're like, if I got the person who switches from not buying to buying, maybe they're the person who's like, I would have felt guilty paying only a penny for it. But now I feel fine. Here's a penny. And you can imagine, even the people who are paying a lot in this 55%, maybe the next time they pay, they're like, "Well, I paid a lot last time," and so that's a concern. So to this, I have two responses, and because I think it is a big issue. And when I talk to companies, they are always super concerned. Like if I say you should try pay what you want, they say it will never work, right? People are going to pay less and less. So from I work with a company that sells digital books online, has been in business for about 2 years, and so they sell bundles of books every 2 weeks. Many of their customers come back every 2 weeks and buy books, and there is essentially no attrition in their, no reduction in their payments, so they're stable, right? And that's, so they are definitely comfortable in that payment situation. But the other one, we think about novelty, one of the analogs to pay what you want that we should be all comfortable with is charitable giving, right? Charitable giving is like, that's pay what you want, but it's in the sense of it's donate what you want, and it's donate what you want for essentially getting nothing in return, right? And you say, oh, and there, you know, not everybody gives to charity all the time, but I have gotten comfortable. We don't freak out about it, like, oh my gosh, should I donate $6 or $6.25? You just say, like, oh, I'm gonna choose to donate and I'm comfortable with it. And so there's some reason to believe that comfort could come in here without destroying the market, but totally important question to be thinking about.
Is there a way to
Oh, that's interesting. That's, I mean, so if it's, so if it's time, that's, so if I reduce my my measurement of cognitive demand, I say all I'm talking about is how long it takes them to do it. I should be able to observe that. I'm trying to think of if my book vendor, he on the other hand is good. Actually, his wife does all the programming. but they're both Berkeley grads, by the way, that run that company. It is possible they might be able to do that. That's interesting, and I haven't thought about it. 55% again is less, and you can see the difference in price. They're paying $6.43 on average, right? And so you say, and then I have this profit column. The profits are all about the same, right? So this one certainly isn't sending the signal of like, oh, it's the secret to success, but it's also saying it's not a disaster, right? So I find the 64 versus 55 is going to be important. That matters a lot, and I think that's interesting. But we say, first of all, people pay more underpay what you want than under the high price. That's good. That confirms some sensitivity. People pay more than they have to. We already had seen that before, but it's good to see it again. And then this last one, they're less likely to buy at pay what you want than at a low fixed price. And that, actually, this is a pretty reliable finding across studies. And I still find it kind of surprising because it just seems like it goes against everything that price should do. But once you take a step back and all the human stuff that we've been talking about, like what's it like to be in there, you start saying, oh yeah, okay, maybe part of what it is that people are avoiding purchase because it is more stressful to pay an amount that's inappropriate than to not buy it at all, right? And so now we're ending up with people paying more. Yeah? Yeah.
Avoid. I don't trust anything that's like that at all. And so I would just avoid. I mean, I truly would be one of the people who, I don't buy pictures like this, but if I were to buy pictures, I'd be much more likely to buy it at a low price than at a pay-as-you-want model. So I represent that.
Yeah.
That this surprising insight is
that you're like, that's you. Yeah.
And the reason why I would see that, and I would be like, oh, just stay away from that.
Interesting.
Mm-hmm. Maybe it's a question of, you know, which business model makes more sense to you, or what you're more comfortable with. Do you want the fixed price, or do you want to pay what you want? And then I'll tell you, expose the fixed price to you, and that's the way you go. Or the pay what you want, and I will give you an
interesting. In which case, I would choose to pay the fixed price.
Right. Yeah.
You guys are totally spot on in thinking about it, right? So you say there is some notion. Now you think of it as a gimmick, and you might say so. But let's the gimmick makes it seem like, oh, it's kind of pejorative, right? Like, oh, it's
there's something else to it.
Right, but it's at the very least.
I'm gonna have to get my email address, and then they're gonna,
right. No,
you're or they're gonna solicit me for this other thing, and I'm gonna have to stay in there for 15 minutes and like listen to the sales pitch or whatever. I don't know what it is. I don't know it yet.
Yeah.
But
no,
it's trying to engage with this thing. I've stepped into it, and I'm no longer.
So this idea that you say there's no free lunches, or what you're saying to yourself, what's the catch? What's the catch here? The benefit that it's a concern. I think it's part of the friction. But again, we're using products that are transparently available, right? It's a photo. It's that photo, right? If you said, oh, they're going to want my email address, you're like, no, there's no email address wanted here, right? And so you say, or like selling donuts or selling coffee, you're like, it's just this donut. Right? It's not like a subscription service to donuts or something, right? So, but it is, it's worthwhile thinking that it definitely sends signals of this is different than what I usually see, right? Which gets to your question about actually what you said about like, well, wait a minute, what happens over time if people do become more comfortable with it? And we can sort of think about that a little bit more. Yeah. Cool. You guys are fun. Museums. So museums are the that's second only to donuts. Is how much data I have from museums, from running experiments at museums. It's largely because they are, as you say, they kind of have that default. Like, so if you've been to the Met in New York, like they have a version, actually it's a lot like Cards Against Humanity's version of pay what you want, where they're like, hey, the suggested price is 20. No, they actually say the price is 20. And you're like, I heard it was pay what you want. And you're like, yeah, if you're a jerk face, right? And so they're like, they really want the 20. And so But a lot of museums, but it is the same idea. Suggested price, a suggested price is kind of what's in there. And so I have a lot of data looking at how those suggestions influence things. They're not as big a factor as you think, right? Mostly people have some sense of what these things are worth, and that matters a lot. But if I said, hey, I'd really like, so at one of the museums, we ran a study where we said, today the most you can pay is $100. Or we said, the most you can pay is $5. There's no difference in how much people pay, right? Even though five is slightly lower than they usually pay, and 100 is, not surprisingly, quite a bit higher, people have a sense of museum. Five and 100, they're like, eh. They're not, people aren't that easily influenced. Yeah?
Have you done any studies where it's not an option to pay nothing?
Yep.
So you have to pay something?
Like 1 cent.
Yep.
Yeah.
A number. And actually, the reason, and those, it's not that I was intrinsically interested in that question, but I have a lot of data because companies, that is where they draw the line in taking on risk. They just can't handle it. Even if I say, no, it'll be fine, you'll make money. They're like, yeah, no, let's set a minimum price of at least, you know, X dollars. So the biggest change, actually, I showed you this from the musician. I have another set of data for a video game seller where their minimum price was a penny, right? And the behaviors look quite a bit different. And I attribute that mostly to, I have to get a credit card out of my pocket. Yeah, that is interesting. Yeah, he should have included it in his survey. I didn't write the survey. yeah.
What about comparing the unit economics of a Panera Cares to a traditional Panera? Because they have nonprofit Panera Cares that operate under a pay what you want model, and I think they're not as profitable as a traditional for profit Panera. But if you factor in maybe the marketing, the PR value, and
That is a very prescient question. So he asks about Panera Care. So Panera makes food, it's a restaurant, right? They have a few restaurants around the country, I think they have four now or something, that have pay what you want menu items. And they give that money to charity. It is, as you say, it's mostly designed to be PR. And they talk as though it's profitable. But they won't talk to me directly. They will not take my calls, which I find actually irritating. I'm actually sort of irritated by Panera, all I want to do is talk to them, and they won't. But I think, so they're a little coy. But you can imagine the PR value might be substantial, even if it doesn't have monetary value. The standards that I'm using, where I'm just looking at how well it does at the tiller, is a pretty high bar, right? Because you can imagine, hey, this could be hugely successful, like picture Radiohead. Or even the other artist I had, like, his success is not the money, it's getting hundreds of thousands of people to listen to his music, so they go to his shows, right? I have till 12:30, is that true? Does someone know?
Yeah.
Cool, thank you for the confirmation. So I'm gonna pause at many, many moments, but let me get through a couple more things so we can talk about those couple other things also. So here's me explaining why I think that they're buying, pay what you want, buying it less. I say, this is what I generally think turns into all of that friction, is that you say, my payment is diagnostic of who I am. And you can think of that as a good person pays a lot. A bad person pays less. I don't want to be a bad person. But I don't want to pay a lot. That's a good reason to not, buy a photo. It is notable, I work with an economist on this project, and he refuses to put this on his slides because he's like, no, a good person might pay a lot, but a smart person pays less, right? And there is a way of thinking about it, of course, like that. And actually, that shows up all the time. They pay what you want. It's not just all generosity. People don't want to feel like a sucker either. So when pay what you want is dangled in front of you, you might say, hey, I'm gonna pay a lot because I'm super generous. But you don't look around and be like, wait a minute, if everyone else is paying pennies, I'm going to be a total schmuck if I pay $20, right? So there's a sense of actually hitting it right on both sides. Okay, so people don't know what a fair price is, so they opt out. And so now I'm going to say what fairness is some notion of what's socially appropriate. Like, what do other people do? What seems reasonable? Well, that means if I can operate on how social the situation is, on how social the payment feels in a few different ways, then I should change how people behave. So I'm going to show you a couple of studies, one which is simple and small, but it demonstrates something. The other one's going to be much bigger. So for this next one, I worked with a local coffee vendor, Dr. Ola, who makes fancy, super organic coffee. There's Dr. Ola in his gold suit. And so he distributes his coffee at farmers markets and that sort of thing around the Bay Area. What we did is we went to his Jack London Square location and for a number of farmers markets, basically ran this extremely simple manipulation. Some people, we said, today you can pay what you want for a cup of coffee. Other people, we said, essentially, today you can pay what you want for a cup of coffee. A person, so everyone knows they can get it for free, and then you say, a person who came earlier paid for your coffee, so your coffee's paid for, and you have a chance to pay it forward to a person who's going to come later. Now, I'm not giving you all the text, but it's worth noting, this is purely symbolic, right? That is to say, everybody gets coffee at any price they want to pay today. But for some people, they're labeling it as, you are buying a coffee for someone else, and someone else bought a coffee for you. It is just a labeling. And what do you see? You see that people pay more, substantially more, under this pay it forward than under pay what you, than under just regular pay what you want. Right? Again, it's same product, same flexibility. It just feels different. And
is there a reference price and pay it forward?
For none of these is there's a reference price. When you give, it's funny. I've studied this now quite a bit. People desperately want a reference price, right? All the times, but especially under pay it forward, because the reference price they want is how much did the guy pay for mine, the person who came before me. And so we ran a study where we give people that information. We sort of lie to them. We say, this is how much the last person paid, and so we can vary what that amount is. And man, their payments now, they are really locked into those, because that isn't just what they want, that is the narrative they desperately want to follow. Oh, the last person paid $1.50? $1.50. The last person paid $2.50? $2.50. Yeah. Yeah?
Olivia mentioned that it's the regular place where the coffee gets sold. Mm-hmm. So you could make the assumption that some people are repeat customers. What does the coffee usually sell for?
Yeah. So this is that fact, which I don't have on here, makes this sad slide. He usually sells coffee for $3. So pay what you want is worse than pay it forward, but they are both worse than just selling it for the same high price he usually sells it for. Right, I know, yeah, so you say, but he must sell more. Well, first of all, no, he doesn't. But number two, coffee, you have to think coffee is an unusual product. Part of the reason that we don't do a lot of coffee stuff is that coffee typically, people are price insensitive and at roughly speaking, infinite demand, right? That is say, you go to you're like, I want a cup of coffee. There's a coffee guy. And you go over there, and I know this from other studies, that we can randomly assign fixed prices to people, conditional on saying they want a cup of coffee, and they basically never opt out, right? Because they're like, I want a coffee. It's $10. All right. Once they're there, then they're in. And so there's very little difference. So pay what you want looks cool on a sign, but it doesn't really draw people in. But also I think that's just because if you want coffee, you want coffee, right? Done. And if you don't want coffee, pay what you want's not going to make you like, well, I usually drink Coke, but man, pay what you want coffee. I'm going to get in on that. It's not good for you. So it's an unusual in this category. We're not seeing an increase. There's other domains where it does. Yeah, in the back.
So most of the examples we looked at have a pretty low consideration percentage, and the units or the marginal cost for each other unit is in the single digits.
Yep.
What happens when it's the cost is in the tens or twenties or hundreds of dollars value?
Yeah. Yeah, so she asks, what happens if the marginal costs are high, or higher. Coffee's cheap to make. Digital downloads are really cheap. So one version is, I don't know, but I think that's a silly thing to say. I would say, you totally shouldn't even vaguely try this with things that have high marginal costs. Like, it's not like, pay what you want, BMW dealer. Don't do that. Like, that's a terrible idea, right? But there is some room. I'll show you some data at the end that people will pay a lot in certain situations. So it's not that the margins have to be zero, but you have to be sensitive. So it's a reasonable question. You want to be thinking about that. Again, when I talk to companies, they have that. That's the other one they have in mind, right? So the first one they have is like, this is how we do with our fixed prices. It seems to be working fine. Are you really going to do better than that? Reasonable question. And they say, wait a minute. It costs me X dollars to serve each customer. I'm willing to try your experiment, but not if I'm like going to go hugely into the red on this. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's there. So there's no data on that. I've gotten pretty close. There's a couple of firms that want to try it. They want to do business to business, where they provide a service that is actually pretty expensive, on the order of like sort of $5,000 per unit, and they have some belief after reading one of my papers that they're like, this could totally work. They're still a little gun-shy, but maybe they'll get there, and then I'll be able to give this amazing story about how even business-to-business could work. But mostly, yeah, I'm working in business-to-consumer.
Are you a little
nervous about it? I can't imagine that business-to-business would work, right? Because you'll get someone on the other end of the business who's like, wait a minute, I just paid you $5,000 last month. Now I can pay zero? Sweet. but I don't know. So it all depends. It's really about how much human there is within the business-to-business transaction. Give me your question.
Have you done this research in different cultural contexts? Like some mainstream culture like these, they feel not guilty having free stuff.
Yeah. It's good. So most of my consumers are, like, in all settings, they are American. They are overwhelmingly from the Bay Area. That being said, that is not all of them. So my online book vendor distributes about 80% to the US, but then a bunch in Europe. He doesn't see differences in how they behave. The biggest set of data that I saw was work. There's a company in San Francisco called Humble Bundle that sells bundles of video games. They are a multi-million dollar company. So they won't share their data with me because I think they're going to go public and all that sort of stuff. But they're just a pay what you want company that does very well. And in chatting with them, I was able to, they showed me a figure showing me differences from different countries. And you do see differences. So that is to say the US is pretty high in how much they pay. Australia is higher than the US. England is a little lower. And then basically a handful of Asian countries are a lot lower in theirs. But again, if you took a step back, you'd look at it and be like, but they're all really similar, right? So I'm sure there are cultural variations, but I haven't systematically studied them. I'm giving you the few facts that I know. Cool. All right. So people pay more under pay it forward. Oh, here, this is me simply. I showed you just that one figure. When I try to get companies to do experiments with me, so this is what I do for a living, is try to run field experiments with firms, right? This is one of the things I pitch. Is pay it forward, because it's like it's every time shows an effect, right? It's kind of neat that like it's that reliable across many different contexts. So it's museums, it's doughnuts, it's coffee mugs, it's coffee, it's and books, right? All of these things, it shows up. Good. So one practical problem is that this is a long narrative to explain the pay it forward thing to people, and it seems weird, right? You're like, the last person paid for me. It's even more weird than just pay what you want. You say, I want something that's more streamlined, something that's easy, but still feels social, engages my social preferences in a meaningful way. So I'm going to do something much more familiar, and I'm going to look at charity. So for this last study, we went to a very large amusement park. Actually, it's funny. I'm not allowed to tell you what the amusement park is, but I am allowed to tell you, I did this in collaboration with Disney Research. They have lawyers vet every single document ever, and yet they're like, no, you can totally say that. It's crazy. They're amazing in Disney research in working with us. So we go to a very large amusement park. And we go to one ride at that park, where it's like a roller coaster type ride. And while you're on it, they photograph you, and then you can buy a printed out photo at the end of the ride. Not unlike the boat one, okay? So you say, great. Each rider is photographed on the ride. The photo is displayed along with the price on video monitors at the end. Okay, so they don't, unlike the boat, where they print every photo for every person and then they have to like throw them out at the end. This one is only print on demand. So you see them on these video displays as you're exiting. All right. What do the photos look like? This is slightly cropped, but this is an example of the photo. That's a younger, more cheerful version of me. And this is my collaborator. I don't know who these people are behind me. And also, the whole ride is indoors, so I don't know why they're wearing sunglasses. Strange. All right, so, but this is what we're talking about. And you say, so we're going to sell essentially this photo. And what I'm going to manipulate are the prices. So, of course, here's the regular price. They're fixed price, $12.95, which I can give you a long speech about how this company sets prices. If you're wondering, it must be super sophisticated because they're a multi-billion-dollar company. It's not. They set these prices at some point, like whatever, in like the 1930s when they invented photography, that kind of thing. And they're like, yeah, we'll increase them whenever we increase at exactly proportional to the ticket prices for the park. So sort of ignoring digital photography. And oh, sorry, this is totally an aside, but it is such a great observation. I show they're displayed on video monitors because the company hasn't been great with their pricing. You see anybody who's under the age of 20, which is a lot of people, photographs with their phone the image that way, right? So you say, they're like, and again, the company hasn't caught up with the realities. So we do this. But I'm also going to manipulate this a second variable. That is, I'm going to say, so some people are told it's $12.95, other people are told pay what you want. And then these other two groups, they're told, today it's $12.95 and half the money you pay is going to go to charity. Or they're told, today it's pay what you want and half the money you pay is going to go to charity. Okay? Extremely simple to understand what's going on. And it's also worth pausing and recognizing that this is standard corporate social responsibility. Now, mind you, 50% to charity is a very, very large share. But we already know this narrative. And if you want a single stylized finding from research looking at effects of corporate social responsibility in these domains, it's that it is never effective. Right? They're not bad. Right? It's not a bad thing. But the companies want to do good. And the argument is that in order for this general strategy to be effective, you'd want to say, all right, it should be sustainable, right? If I'm going to put $1 million into promoting my new CSR campaign, I should be getting at least $1 million return of extra purchasing. And that it almost never meets that standard. That is to say, CSR, it only rarely works. So we're going to think about that in the background as well. You say, we're going to be able to evaluate that, because I'm going to compare it to what we call shared social responsibility. It's just a label. But it's just saying, hey, in this case, every dollar I spend as a customer, I'm electing to pay it, and I'm sort of now in this contract with the company, with me, with the charity. It's all going to be great, right? And there's some notion that it's all a little bit more shared. Cool. So we ran this for a month at this ride, and so a lot of people go on it. And first of all, purchase rate, 0.5% buy the photo at the regular price. Now, you could look at that and say, that is a small number. But you could also look at it and say, that's a big number. It's $12.95 for a photo that cost about 92 cents to print, right? So that's a pretty massive margin. And a lot of people go on this ride, which is the reason they sell these photos. So we have no reason to look at it and say, that is the perfect price. But we can still look at it and say, like, even at a low percent, that's pretty good. Now, what happens when you add the charity? Do more people buy? Not really. Just a tiny bit more, 0.6%. Buy the photo when 50% goes to charity, right? So this is, again, consistent with the idea of corporate social responsibility. It doesn't do much. Right, and the margins are nasty if we think of it and we think of it that way. 8.4% buy it, pay what you want. That is obviously way, way, way higher than the other ones. And now we get to probably my favorite finding from this. And now, when it's pay what you want and half the money goes to charity, fewer people buy. This is an extremely reliable effect. Not just here. I mean, here it's massively statistically reliable, but I mean in many contexts. This is a better photo, if you will. That is, conceptually, it's the same photo, except this one helps out a charity. And they're like, no, I'll take the worst photo, is sort of what the behavior is looking like. That's weird, right? And so we want to, this is getting at the core of what's happening. So first of all, how much do they pay? $12.95, of course, in those. 92 cents is how much they pay under regular pay what you want. 92 cents is exactly how much it costs to print a photo. Actually, it's a little over 92 cents to print a photo. So as again, this is going to be me boasting again, I was able to get a multi-billion dollar company to run an experiment where they lost money. As an academic, that's amazing. Like, I can't even get Panera Bread to take my calls. And they actually did this. The cool thing, of course, is this last one and what that does. They don't just pay more when half the money goes to charity. They pay discontinuously more, right? And so you say, that's $5.33. It's short of $12.95, but it's a lot more than 92 cents. So you say, how much revenue are they getting per writer? And you can sort of go through, it's a lot more revenue per writer that goes through. This number is currently gross. I'll show you how to think about it in terms of the donation and whatnot in just a sec, actually. It's more complicated than dividing by two because I have to handle the cost of printing the photo in order to think about it, because the photos cost something, and that is not absorbed by the charity. It is only absorbed by the company. 50% of the net. It's 50%. It's 50% of any. If you pay $5, I give $2.50 to charity. Of the remaining $2.50 that I kept, I pay for your photo, for the printing, in this setup. Good. Okay, so what does it look like? This is the chart that we were looking for. Post-cost revenue. So this is, now I'm subtracting out how much it costs to print a photo, and we can see, first of all, and I've carved it up so you can see that this is the amount going to charity and amount going to the firm. This is a ride that gets more than 10,000 riders a day on it. So you look at that and you're like, and it's 20 cents per rider. That is a fair amount of money. Notably, this blue bar is higher than either of these. That is to say, if everything goes well from one ride at this one park, I could give a substantial surplus to charity and still be making more money than I would with my fixed prices.
Yep. Charity as well, and that way you would extract a little bit more on that balance. And I'm not sure if it would allow you to take the 92 cents out.
My guess is people wouldn't even notice that they're not saying, like, hold on. But if you want to go even more sinister, I'm gonna be the sinister guy for this narrative. So we want to understand whether it was something special about 50%. So not in this study, but in other studies, I've manipulated the percentage going to charity. Sometimes 100% going to charity, pure donation. Sometimes 99%. Sometimes 50. Sometimes 1% going to charity. If 1% goes to charity, people pay hugely different than if 0% goes to charity. But 1% versus 99%, they look the same. So if you want to get your margins even higher, yeah, give 1% to charity, basically. So actually, we can think about this in one more way, and that is to say, this company, big company, very generous actually, gives a fixed amount every year to this charity. So you could think of all this yellow. That's not more money going to the charity. That's just like an accounting issue. And so you can really think of it like this. And now I've moved from like it's marginally more profitable to I can pay the CEO's salary for like a week. So it's pretty impressive. And again, when we write about it, we talk about how big the numbers could be. Like there's a lot of rides at a lot of parks. This is just one souvenir photo is doing it. Okay. So I want to go through a couple of these briefly. We have like 3 minutes left, and I'm just going to mention these points, and then I'll be around and we can chat. So first of all, people don't go cheap when there's a charity. This is the overwhelming thing. Super big effect, very reliable cross-context. People just don't, that feels bad, right? And it makes sense. That kind of, it's like when it was just pay what you want, you're like, well, maybe I'm getting a good deal. When it's pay what you want in charity, you're like, oh man, I'm definitely going to be a jerk if I don't pay very much here, right? So that's why they're often not buying, right? We see them buying less often. So now you should ask, and this came, what about something that's more expensive, right? So she asked about things with high margins. I'm not gonna give you something with a massively high margin. I'm gonna give you something where the average payment though is considerably higher. So a couple of years ago, the Alumni Association here hosted an event in Beverly Hills where I was speaking to presumably some of your classmates, and I got them to organize the event with a pay what you want admission price. And so you say, okay, here's something where instead of a fixed price, people are going to pay what you want, and we have no idea what it's going to be. Right? There's also no easy reference. Cup of coffee, I say pay what you want, you say, I've been to many coffee shops in my life, that could be as low as 2, as high as 4, but you don't say it could be as high as 1,000. But going to an alumni event, we have no idea. So what is it going to be? You get this quite a large distribution of payments here. It's not super easy to read histogram, but they're basically showing nobody in this entire alumni event paid zero, right? Maybe that's because Berkeley-Haas alumni are just incredibly nice people. But I would have said it's most of the people are nice people. They don't want to pay zero, and they still want to go to the event. But then you see this huge distribution. You have a couple of people who paid $50, right? So you say, there is room. People are willing to pay more for events that they are tied in with, that they care about, right? They're happy to use it as an expression. Yeah?
Will the price change if they were able to pay after the event?
Yeah. It's pretty, yeah, like, because after they'd seen me, they would be like, yeah, yes, I should pay. It's interesting. So I have relatively few, it turns out it's a relatively hard design to do well, to test before and after, so I don't do it here. This is all before, but I have done it at museums where people come in and say, come on in, when you leave, it'll be pay what you want. And we see mild differences that people pay a little bit more after when they're leaving than when they enter. But my guess is it's entirely dependent on the context. How good was the museum, right? How good was the alumni speaker, right? So, okay. This is the last thing I want to end on because I think it just matters a lot. And this is a more general point. What's neat about this project is that the companies had no idea what was going to happen. And I would have said, and you hopefully I've conveyed some of this, I frequently had no idea either, right? That I'm convincing them to run a study because I am interested in the answer because the question is not answered yet, right? And the company has no idea. So we're all in it together. And you might say, well, gosh, running an experiment is risky. Maybe we should just ask people. Turns out if you just ask people, like run a survey, hey, how much would you pay in this situation? Would you buy? Those answers are unrecognizable in terms of reality. That is, if you say, hey, would you buy a photo that was pay what you want and half went to charity? 85% of people say, absolutely. Then you say, how much would you pay? And they give numbers that are a joke, right? And so they just can't picture what it's like to be in that situation. You have to run the study to learn it. And running the study, you get to learn these things that are real and actionable and novel, right? So at the end of that last study, there was the simplest possible piece of consulting advice I get to offer to the photo manager there and be like, you want to set this price, do this, and you will make this much more money, right? And with all of the fun insight that comes out of learning about people that we couldn't have gotten in any other way. All right, I'm not going to go over time, so I'll stop. Thanks.